All right, my name's Cricket. This is our 6 to 7 o'clock Sunday night meeting. We call it Project Inside of Hope. But what we're trying to do is send some hope to the inside. Y'all will recognize some faces as we go around the room. We also got some newcomers and we got some family members here. So what we'll do is we'll start up there and everybody just say your name. And you know, if you're a family member, just say I'm such and such, mom or sister or whatever. I'm Kurt, my daddy.
I'm Kurt.
I'm Sherry, Kurt's mother.
Hey, Sherry. Welcome.
I'm Sherry, Matt's mom.
Hey, Sherry.
I'm Matt, my daddy.
Hey, Matt.
Mark, Matt's father.
Hey, Mark. Welcome.
I'm Ashley. I'm an addict.
Hey, hey Ashley. Welcome. I'm Cricket.
Hey, Cricket.
I'm Dreama with Cricket.
I'm Paul. I'm an addict.
Hey, Paul.
I'm Ron. I'm an addict.
Hey, Ron.
I'm Roxy and Cody's mom.
Hey, Roxanne, welcome.
Cody, I'm an addict.
Hello, Cody.
My name's Floyd, I'm an alcoholic.
Floyd, welcome.
And Ryan, I'm an addict.
Hey, Ryan.
My name's Brad, I'm an addict.
Hey, Brad.
My name's Mike, I'm an addict.
Hey, Mike, welcome. All right, so I passed out these papers to the family members. It's called Symptoms for Family to Look Out For, and it's got... Boy, y'all in trouble, because this is like a cheat sheet for your mamas and your daddies and your wives and your husbands. They got the drop on us, man. You can't get any better than this. So what I want y'all family members to do, if you don't mind, while we go around the room with the participants and they share on what they did this week, maybe y'all can browse over this and see if anything jumps out at you. So when we get to you, maybe you can share on it if you'd like to. Kurt, what's been going on this week? You doing all right?
Yeah, man, I'm doing good. I've worked all week, and then yesterday, I went with my little brother out to Chesapeake, Virginia, and we played this airsoft thing. Mm-hmm. They got this big field out there. I forget how many acres it is, but you go out there and you just pretty much shoot people. It's fun, man. It's like paintball, but airsoft gun, you know, plastic pellets and stuff.
Does it hurt?
Yeah, if you get in the right spot, it hurts.
Oh my god. Turn around, should be zooming on that thing. Wow. I ain't sure if I'm gonna make that much fun to me or not.
It's all in good fun though, you know.
Well, she had a little lips or something.
You get it yet?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Not a zit, it's a pellet.
And a hickey. It's not a hickey because it's too small. Yeah. We'll buy that, Kurt. We'll buy that just for today. Yeah. So you go out there and does it cost a lot?
Not really, no. Like, you've got your own gun and vest and everything and stuff like that. You should pay $25 for the whole day. You play from 9 to 5, and they do like different types of games and stuff. And then at the end, they do this game called Zombies. And it's just like in like, what's that game?
Call of Duty.
Yeah, Call of Duty. Like, and you just start off with like one zombie, and you shoot him, and you go back to the woods. He's got to respawn, and comes back, and whoever he shoots, you become a zombie. So at the end of the game, there's all these zombies, and then there's like two people left, and all of them run to it and just. You get shot by literally hundreds of people, thousands of times. You're just like, oh, okay.
I get it.
It's fun,
awesome.
Man.
That's cool. Who all went? You said you took your little brother?
Yeah, my little brother and me went down there.
That's cool. Fun, man. Mom, you didn't go?
No.
You're not interested in shooting your kids with the airsoft gun?
No, not if they're going to shoot back.
That's a good point. Well, that sounded like fun though, Kurt, for real, man. You had just took your little brother out. You said it was his birthday?
No.
Just
to go.
He was planning on going, I think.
Well, he asked me, my little brother asked me if I wanted to go. He had told me when I was locked up, you know, he started doing this airsoft. I was like, man, I'm trying to do that when I get out.
Hold on, I'm women now, because this is new to me. So you got your little brother, how old is he?
20.
Wants to spend time with you.
Yep. Well,
that's crazy, man.
Yep.
But that's what happens when you're doing good, though, right? Because at one point in our lives, not a whole lot of people was wanting to come around us. Damn sure won't call us, inviting us tonight. All right, well, that's good, man. I'm going to come back to the parents. What do you do this week, man?
Last weekend I went to the Green Bay Carolina game. Unfortunately, we lost, just like we lost the game today. I don't know what's going on, but...
You still rocking the gear, though.
Yeah, still prepping my team. This week I worked and went to meetings for the fellowship I go to. And like the past 2 weeks I've been struggling a little bit, but like I just kept trying to do the right thing, and every time I did, it was always a blessing on the other side. I got moved into an apartment with some people from my recovery organization that I'm involved with, and that's going great. Everything's going pretty good for the most part. I stepped on a nail the other day at work. That wasn't too fun, but Yeah, it got stuck in there pretty good, but I didn't have to use over it, so.
Good, man.
Everything's going pretty good overall. Did some step work today, so that was good.
What step are you working on?
Step 2. Just finished it. So
that's good.
Step 3 will be next.
So you starting, as if you didn't already know, you starting to understand the way you was living was insane, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Right, yeah, we do a lot of crazy stuff, man. So you got, you and 3 other guys, right?
Yeah.
Moved into this apartment. It's owned by the organization that you participate in.
Mm-hmm.
So they got 68 participants in their program, and they chose 4 people to move into this apartment as like a test run to see how the participants were going to do in it. Yeah. And they chose you and 3 other people.
One of them, yeah.
Does that make you feel good?
I mean, I don't know. I don't know why exactly they chose me or us, but I mean,
might have something to do with the fact that you're doing pretty good, man.
Yeah.
Matt's real active. Matt uses his network. He picks the phone up if he's having a hard time. He picks it up if he's having a good time. So he's doing pretty good, man. We all love him around here. Anything else going on this week? The nail, man. Y'all check them pictures out when you get out on Facebook. You got them all over Facebook.
One of the big ones, too. It was like one of the ones that are like as wide as a cigarette around, like that long.
Oh,
got stuck through my Red Wing boots. It wasn't like I was wearing tennis shoes.
That might as well have been a gutter spike, man. That
yeah, he got me good.
How you doing?
What's happening? I didn't do much this week, just work, but my sister took me out last night for my birthday to watch the UFC fight.
Hell yeah.
Done much.
Well, today's your birthday, right?
Yeah, today's my birthday.
Well, that's next up, man. Oh! All right. The spankings will be at the end of the show. So, you still working at the same place?
Yeah, I'm still there.
You like it?
It's all right.
Well, yeah. Sometimes it gets better, sometimes it gets a little stressful, I'm sure. But the good news is you're working. You ain't got to ask mom and daddy for a dime. You ain't got to steal nothing out of nobody's pocketbook. You ain't got to go to Walmart. You ain't got to do none of that, man, because you're working.
Step on nails.
You do. No, you ain't got to step on nails because they ain't got no nails where you work at. They got some hooks there. I don't think you're going to step on them, but. Yeah, that's good, man. Anything interesting?
He loves
them. No, my kids called me today and told me happy birthday.
Well, that
was awesome.
Good stuff.
Yeah.
You ain't doing nothing tonight?
I'm going out to dinner tonight.
Good.
Sushi.
Sushi?
Huh?
That's cool, man. Mm-hmm. I went out last night to a Vietnamese. What was it, Vietnamese?
Yeah.
I ain't know what to order, man. I better not say what I get ready to say because we're all public, but I picked something to order. It was pretty good.
Yeah.
Well, that's cool, man. You know, when was the last time you had a birthday sober or not in jail?
I don't know. Probably when I was like 15.
You see what I'm saying? It's been a while. Yeah. So this is a new experience for you. You doing all right with it?
Yeah, I'm doing
all right
with it.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Thank you.
All right. Paul, you're new here, man. What have you heard about this group?
I just found out about this group tonight from Ashley.
Good job.
She said, some people that just got out of jail, and I'm in the Rockwood County Drug Court. I've been clean since October 2nd. I've been shooting dope for the last 3 years, been hooked on opiates for the last 5 years. Just trying to do the right thing this time. Brought back some new charges. I was on probation, so that's why they offered me drug court and they're 5 years over my head. So I'm behaving myself now. I'm still looking for a job and stuff. It's hard as a felon to find a job, but taking it one day at a time and really opening up in my therapy sessions in drug court about some things, about why I may use the way I do. So that's a big thing to get off my chest. Because I've been in treatment like 5 times, been in the RISE program twice, and I never really opened up about everything. I gave them a little bit here and there, but I never really told them everything that went on in my past and everything. So I think by letting that out, I'm really allowing myself to take in recovery at 100% this time. So that's what I'm doing.
Good for you, man.
Good.
So you've been clean since October 2nd?
Yes, sir.
What's that? That's over a month.
That's like 44 days.
That's 44 days. 44 days is a long time to put together, man, when you first do this thing. I come to think of it, since you told me your name, your last name, I recognize the name. You were definitely in the RISE program.
Yes, sir.
Once or twice or 10 times. How many times I've been in there. But it's good to see you outside, man. We For the record, man, all the participants in here have been in jail before. Some of us have been in jail a lot, some of us have been in jail for a short time, but we all been in jail, so we can relate to y'all, and hopefully y'all can relate to us. So you got drug court and stuff. That's actually a pretty good opportunity, man, because it gives you a chance to get out of jail and try to at least get your life together so you ain't got to go back.
Well, you know, man, that's why I chose. I mean, I didn't really have that much of a choice considering the time I had over my head, but at the same time, I knew every time that I got clean before, I never really hit the ground running with, like, finding a job and stuff like that. I haven't worked since April of last year, a legal job. So I know this is going to force me to get out there and do something I'm not comfortable doing. And I knew I needed that structure, otherwise I was going to die like so many other people I know that have died. And like, everyone's killing people today, like nobody's business. So I'm actually grateful to be in drug court. I'm grateful just to be free. I'm grateful to be alive, you know? So that's where I'm at today.
Good for you, man. I'm glad you came. Look, you would actually, man, set him up with a job. For real, because, I mean, they hire, man, and they, you know, they don't even do background checks. But the truth is, if they do a background check, they'll still hire you.
Right?
Your background ain't gonna hold you back.
They don't even ask if you're a
felon. Right. We're not gonna say the company name on camera because we don't want to trick nobody up. But there is work out there, man. And I think you, if you ask around, you'll see, man, a lot of us were discouraged too because we didn't think nobody was gonna hire us and we gave up and went back selling drugs, stealing, all the stupid stuff we do, man. But truth is, man, work's out there and it'll work you, man, especially if you committed to it and you're showing some kind of initiative.
Yes,
Michael, we're glad you came this week. Ron, what's going on, man?
Man, just holding on.
Hanging on.
Just keeping it real, man. Just trying to stay in the moment. You know, things aren't always easy.
Right.
You know, I think what it is a lot of times when I've heard a lot, like, when we get clean, we tend to get our feelings back, which is pretty good. But then the bad thing is you get your feelings back, you know. I've always been used to putting stuff on top of that, you know, getting high over certain feelings.
So. All right. You said something about living in the moment, man. That's important for people like us because we tend to dwell on the past and feel guilty and, you know, shame and all that. And bad feeling does what for us? I don't know what bad feeling makes us do. Makes us feel bad, man. And we tend to use drugs and stuff so that we'll feel better, right? So we try not to dwell on the past. The past is the past. We can't do nothing about it, man. So, you know, that living in the moment thing is very essential for somebody like us.
I've been trying this for a long time. And in and out. You know, landing in jail, going to prison, going to institutions. So it's important to try and live in that moment and stay positive. Because when I dwell on stuff, it's like it keeps me sick. It keeps me real sick. And I've been able to, like, get out of that this time around. Because, yeah, I mean, like I said, this is definitely not my first rodeo trying to get clean. I think what it is, it's definitely harder to get clean than it is to stay clean.
Oh, yeah.
You know, once I can get clean, then it's kind of maintaining. My medicine now is like the meetings, you know. And that's what I've learned, that it's just the drugs that I do is just a symptom of the disease I got. And, you know, when you're sick or you got a cold, you got to take medicine for it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So my medicine is obviously the fellowship, Narcotics Anonymous, which seems to help.
Right. So this is kind of like your medicine here.
Yeah, this is medicine right here.
Giving back, spreading a message of hope.
Yeah, that's right.
That keeps you clean, right?
That's it.
Me too. Cody, what did you do this week? Nothing?
Play video games.
Stare at the wall. Well, that ain't true, Cody. I saw Cody. Cody came up here to McShin Foundation the other night.
I came a couple meetings last week.
Right.
Just been hanging out with a buddy of mine, man. Helping him. He was spray painting his motor last week. So we were doing that. And then been gaming, came to a couple meetings. Went up to my church over the week and saw a few people. And saw my nephew and I got like a job offer from my cousin wants me to help in the power wash possibly. And I'm like, I've done like a lot of power washing jobs in the past. I'm really good at that. It's one of my little things on my resume at the car wash, like, professionally, so he's like, so he hit me up about that. He's like, he might want me to help him do that. So, let's see what's going on with that. Kind of looking into schools. I need to start looking at more schools soon, seeing if I'm going to go to school here next year.
Code 19 is 2 months.
Yeah, she's starting what? Less than 2 months.
Yeah, because he has, like, you call your colors in every day.
Yeah, I got
that one. That messed everything up. Pre-trial. Just
office. But it's not going to be forever, so.
You're on color code for your probation officer, pre-trial, or CCP, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
How many people here have been on color codes?
Shit.
Have you ever been on color codes in your life? How many people have ever been on color codes and now because they're doing something different is not on it anymore?
What was the question?
How about that? If you've ever been on color codes and are no longer required to do that kind of stuff because you live in a different way, raise your hand. So look, that's three people in this little circle right here, man. So if we can do it, y'all can do it. It can be done. You ain't got to pay nobody because I'm broke. It would have never happened if that was the case. But you do something different, man. You know, yeah. Keep doing like you're doing, man. Chances are they're going to take you off of that stuff. But it's good to know you ain't just been sitting around playing video games staring at the wall, because that, you know, that don't do nothing but lead to trouble with people like us, right?
Yeah. Yeah, I try and space out my game.
We love Kevin, man.
But, I passed all my drug tests so far. I've had like 5 or 6 drug tests so far, I think. So I passed all of those, you know, I'm doing good. My PO is cool with me and stuff. We got a pretty good relationship when it comes to the legal system. You know, he knows I'm doing right. And I know, like, as long as I keep doing right, everything will go decent, you know. So.
Good for you, man. Good thing about drug tests, man, is, the easiest test in the world to take because you ain't got to study for them.
Yeah.
You ain't got a cram the night before. Just don't use, right? You pass the test. If that's something, don't use the day no matter what. And keep doing that every day. And you pass them every time. Ain't that cool?
Yeah.
That's pretty cool. Glad y'all made it this week. Floyd, what you been up to? Floyd, it's your first week up here. What you heard about this group?
I heard about it from a couple of people in the program. And I'm trying to do this time as much as I possibly can. You know, I've been in and out. I'm basically just coming back. It's like a little over 30 days.
Good for you, man.
Yeah. Where I'm at now compared to 30 days ago is absolutely crazy.
Right.
I mean, you know, sleeping in the woods, barns, and, you know, not working, not doing nothing, ripping and running. It's amazing, man. You know, it truly is. just been working and doing meetings, man, staying around. You know, positive people. You know, people like Riggs, and you know, I make phone calls all the time. You know, trying to stay in touch with people. You know, I went to prison at 19. You know, my very first time ever being locked up, and it's just been a cycle ever since. And it came from music, and that's kind of what I've dealt with for, you know, 37 now. You know, so just trying to get this thing, man. And the thing is after I learned this and how the program is. You know, when I was using, I already knew there was a better way and how to do it. My problem is the way I grew up, I want to do everything myself and I don't want to ask for no help.
Right.
And it was hard this time, man. I'm in a recovery house now. I was in one last year and I had like 9 months clean and then, you know, messed that all up or whatever. But, you know, I swallowed my pride this time, man. As low as I was, you know, I called the dude up and, you know, I was kind of worried about what he would say. And he was like, dude, I got you. You know, and that's hard for me to, you know, to accept, man. You know, I'm always worried about what somebody else is thinking and all this, that, and the other. And all I had to do was make a phone call and it worked out. And 30 days, man, it's come a long way.
30 days is a long time for
me. I got twin 6-year-old boys, and yesterday I spent the day with them, you know, just kicking around and, you know, shooting little Nerf guns and, you know, wrestling around. I broke my shoulder and, you know, just awesome, man. You know, them kids are everything to me, man.
Yeah. And also see them pictures on Facebook.
Yeah. Yeah. That's cool. I love my kids, man. And, you know, sometimes I try not to dwell on the shit I've done, you know, so I can, you know, be back with them kids, man. You know, because a lot of times when I sit here and dwell on stuff, it'll eat me up.
Damn, you know, right.
So I stay with positive people, give me some positive information, and leave all them old friends alone, and I wouldn't even call them friends, associates, people that just don't give a crap. So things are a lot better, man. Things are great, I'm working, I got plenty of money. Things are going good.
You aren't dirt man nothing this week.
No. He ain't looking for me, so.
You ain't borrowing on Monday night, so I pay you Thursday. Forgot who you borrowed from.
Not today.
That's good shit for me. I'm so glad you made it. I've known Floyd for years. I know most of the participants in here. I just met some of the parents today, but yeah, Floyd, man, Floyd. I'm so glad to have Floyd here, because anybody that knows you real positive, man. When you on a roll, you on a roll, man. But we also know that you got that pride thing. It's hard for somebody, especially somebody our age, man, to reach out and ask somebody for help. Because we men, and we think we can
take care of myself.
We can run the world. But we can't. We find that now because we always run the world slapping to the ground. So, you know, it's pretty cool that you humbled yourself, man, and reached out. Because the last 30 days, I'm sure, is better than the last 30 months.
And it's amazing. All right. Amazing, man.
When was the last time you were in jail?
I had a probation violation last year. I had an original charge. It was 2012 or whatever it was for possession. Gave me like 3 years. Had to do like 9 months. And then I didn't deal with the probation. You know, I just kind of bucked on them and because I started using. And, you know, eventually they caught up with me. And, gave me 90 days, so I got out. It's kind of funny, it's like every time I get locked up, it's always the holidays. Never fails, man.
So, all right, because you know holidays coming up, man.
Yeah.
What is your plan? No, I'm not jinxing. No, my very important plan for the holidays.
Because I actually ran into a task force, and that was my whole mentality of when I ran into them was,
here we go.
I was ready to take the ride again. You know what I mean? And that's how sad it was. Man. You know, I've dealt with the police all my life, man. And it just clicked in my head, like, dude, I've got to do something, man. It's every single time, and it gets shorter and shorter for me. Mm-hmm. You know, the run gets shorter and shorter. It's not long before I'm wide open, and there they are. You know, and it's kind of crazy how, like, I'm not scared of the police. It's just like, well, here we go. This is what I do. And, you know, it's kind of sad, man. You know, like, it ain't that big of a deal. But for some reason, something clicked, man. I was like, I got to do something, man. You know, I can't keep living like this. And I know there's something else out there. I know there's people that give a crap about me. I just got to step up to the plate and do something, man. You know,
yeah.
I got to do some work if I want something better.
That's exactly right, and you're doing it now, man, so you should definitely be proud of you and your clean time, man, because, you know, like I said, that first 30, man, that's a lot. That's hard to put that together sometimes, man. In fact, it's hard to put together most of the time. So, real quick before we move on to Ryan, when you went to jail this last time, did you sit around and play spades and masturbate, or did you do something productive with your time? Sorry about your language, Mom.
I went to prison at 19, so I learned a bunch of stuff from a lot of older guys that have been doing time a long time. So I always learned to, and I was sober when I'm in jail or prison. Mm-hmm. So I always put my time to something that's useful, that's going to benefit me. It's the streets that always killed me. So I always went to programs, whatever. You know, helping people in there if I could, you know, GEDs or, you know, I definitely ain't a dumb person. So, like, anytime I was locked up here in RICO, I always went to the RISE program.
Right.
You know, I always did that kind of stuff. I knew I needed something to occupy my time and do something positive and fill my brain with something I know I needed. You know, I didn't sit around and play cards and wash somebody's underwear and all that, and I ain't doing none of that. So, you know, positive, man.
Floyd has been in the RISE program a couple times when I was in there, man. And any of y'all have been in the RISE program, any of y'all, the RISE program is a program offered at Henrico County Jail System. It's a behavior modification program. They expose you to Narcotics Anonymous, Alcoholics Anonymous, anger management classes and stuff like that. That's really cool, man. How many of y'all been in the RISE program before? Did it save y'all's life any, man, you think?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so, you know, here's the thing, man, for those of y'all in these programs, the seeds get planted. Whether you, it might not, you know, truth is, man, it might not click this time, but the seeds being planted, man, so just try to absorb what you can. Try not to buck the system too much, because the person that loses in the long run is you, not the deputy, not the advisors or instructors or whatever y'all call them now, peer leaders, y'all. They're not gonna lose no sleep because you get kicked out of the program. None whatsoever. And they ain't gonna get no paycheck for you staying in the program either. They're there as growth members and they're trying to help y'all, man, get seed planted. And here's the good news is that once the seed's been planted with you, then you can turn back around, you can plant in a new couple, man. It's like a circle, man, and we keep each other clean and doing productive things. What's going on, Ryan?
Mine has been working. You know, I work about 6 days this week. You know, just been staying busy, involved with the fellowship that I'm a part of. You know, my homeboy came home last week. It's been nice having him around. He's been with me every night pretty much. You know, going to meetings and, you know, went shopping the other day. Me and my wife's one-year anniversary is coming up this week, you know. I mean, that's just amazing in and of itself. But, you know, there's somebody want to marry my career that be with me for a whole year, you know. And I've been out of jail too, man, I've been out of jail for like a year and a half, man, which is amazing for somebody like me. Because I don't stay out that long. But, I've been doing that stuff. And let's see what else I did this week. I had to spend some time with my daughter, two of my daughters today, took them to the Children's Museum. Took them to lunch, and you know, I just been truly blessed, man. You know, to be able to be present in my own life, and I don't know, man. I'm just grateful. You know, honestly, I got so much stuff going on. And, you know, so busy keeping my schedule full, and you know, being in a part of my own life and being a part of other people's lives too. So it's awesome.
Yeah, well, you're doing really good. The people who's watching this film will recognize that Ryan has been here since the beginning. He ain't messing up. You recognize his face, Trina?
I feel like I know him.
Yeah, he's been, she's a big fan, man. She watches y'all every week, man. Matt, you know, it's a couple of y'all have been here. Ron, he's been here pretty regular since we got him coming. Who else is in here? You've been coming pretty regular since your first week. You've been coming pretty regular. Ashley's committed. She don't want to go nowhere. I don't even have to text her and ask where she's coming because I'm just looking for her to come. So, you know, we're doing pretty good with that. Bradley.
Hey.
What are you doing, man? Hey, look, camera. Bradley's a fool, man. I love him to death, but I swear to God, we can't go nowhere in public because they start kicking us out of places. We have a lot of fun, man. We really do. We have a lot of clean, good fun. What'd you do last night, man?
I
know what I did. They don't know what you did.
I went to the Vietnamese restaurant.
All right, soup.
Soup. I'm 20 pounds. I ordered soup.
Oh my God. Was it good though?
It was all right.
What did the bean sprouts taste like?
Water.
All right. So let me get this straight, man. What did you drink with your meal?
Water.
All right. So you ordered some soup. It was pretty watery. It looked, and the bean sprouts that they gave you to add into it tasted like water, and you drank water too. That sounded pretty square meal to me. What else been going on this week, man? Last week was your first week. You came back, so it must have been something.
My second week here. That's a miracle in itself.
Yes, it is. Yes, it certainly
is. Like me, man, be here twice. You know, I've been doing a lot this week. I got my driver's license back, so I'm mobile now. Spent some time with my nephews. That was cool, man. One's 19, one's 13. The 19-year-old, he probably hate me for this, but you know, he went out with a girl and stuff, man. He spent the night out and all that, you know. But the next morning, you know, he didn't call nobody else to come get him. He wanted to call me to go come get him.
Uncle Brad.
Yeah, he called Uncle Brad to come get him, pick him up. So that was pretty cool. And then the other one, he wanted to play football, and so we passed the football around. Then he wanted to wrestle, and I had to ball him up.
I'm sure. What was he thinking? I don't know.
Yeah, so I went fishing, man. You know, I like to fish a lot, so, you know, I went fishing. I talked to you while I was fishing, matter of fact.
Yeah, you did.
I stopped fishing. I won't catch none. I was just going to enjoy the view.
It was nice that day, though. Like 70-something degrees the other day when he was fishing. He's by himself?
No, not my brother, my nephews.
Oh, did they
come?
Yeah,
they all went together, yeah.
That's cool, man.
Yeah, just staying busy, man. Going to meetings. Been to a meeting every day since I've been home.
Yeah.
Going out to eat, having fun. I owe a lot to this brother right here. Mm-hmm. He's like my rock.
He bought you suit last night, didn't he?
Yeah.
In fact,
trying to tell me something, huh?
In fact, he talked you into ordering the suit.
This suit was good.
P7. That's
the only thing. P7 again. The thing is, we couldn't pronounce nothing on that, so we had to go with the letters and numbers. So Brad ordered P7. He kind of just followed the leader, man, because that's the same thing.
Brian Swartback. It's a ramen suit.
It tastes a whole lot better than a towel.
Ramen suit.
A ramen
suit. I can do some shit with a ramen suit.
Yeah. I see. Yeah, Brad put some stuff together with a ramen suit, man. Yeah, you know, we get in there, man, we get real clever, which, you know, especially though it wasn't in there for a long time, man, we figure it out, man. You know, thank God we ain't got to figure it out no more, but then we go to the grocery store and buy, like, real ingredients and shit. That's pretty cool, man.
Last time I saw Floyd was in the Rise program, Ryan was in the Rise program. Last time I saw Mike, well, not too long ago, we was in a program together at the Verge Center program. So, you know, I see some hope around here. So I know, you know, we're all in the right place.
Oh, yeah,
you know, man. I'd like to see some more people though.
That I shared with the audience last week that I've known you for years and I've never seen you on the street before last week.
Mm.
Yeah. Brad, one of my closest, dearest friends. I love him like a brother. I've never seen him on the street.
No.
Yeah. The last time I did see you before last week was at church service at the jail we was at.
Right.
And Bout got kicked out of there. Cutting up glass and stuff, man. He's a riot, dude. And the cleaner he gets, the funnier he gets, man. The cleaner I get, the more I laugh. So it works out pretty good. Like, I'll scratch your back, you scratch mine, dude. Right. Mike, this your first week here. What'd you hear about the group?
None of the good things.
Ain't heard no bad things, man. Nobody talking about shit about the group.
Really, I haven't heard much. I just heard about it this afternoon.
That's pretty cool. Mike came up here, man. He just heard about it. He came up here on his own. You know, he come up here, volunteered his time to come up, man. Because you been in jail. When was the last time you was in jail?
3.5 months ago.
How long were you in there this last time?
15 months.
15 months, a good little stretch, man. Yeah, so what are you doing this time different than last time so you don't have to go back?
I'm changing people, places, and things, and just trying to stay focused and work and, you know, stay sober.
Good. Talking about people, places, and things, fact is, man, that you moved into a recovery house last week, right?
Yeah, in Sunny House.
That's right, you did. That's part of the McShin Foundation in Richmond. Truth is, man, Mike been trying to get in here for like a month and a half, man. He finally made it, so he's here and he's doing really good, man. We're really glad you came up tonight, because, you know, it's important, man. What jail? What, were you in prison? Were you in jail or what?
I came home from my Divergence Center.
Okay.
In Stafford. It's a work release program.
Brad, is that the one you was in?
Yep.
Oh, cool. So if y'all are seeing this, man, y'all might have seen his face before, and that's the beauty of it, you know, because if you see us out here, I know y'all seen my face before, because I've been in there 1,000 times. And if you see us out here doing something different, man, and we're not in jail, smacking soups on the floor and trying to figure out who's got cheese and who's got little dudes, you know. Can I get that half a pickle? I swear to God, I give it back to you on store day. You know, we're doing this in hopes that y'all will see that stuff, man. We out here, we gotta be doing something right, man, because we're not in there. So the truth is, man, if we can do it, I know damn well if I can do it, and Floyd can do it, and Brad can do it, and I mean all of us, if we can do it, man, y'all can do it too. All right, so this is kind of like a family night, man. I wanted to get some family members in here. I've been wanting to do it for a couple weeks, but, you know, I was just trying to get everybody on the same page. We had a couple other family members that wanted to come and couldn't make it tonight. But that's cool, man, because, you know, I'm sure they'll watch the film. Because the participants that's in this room, their families are really, really proud of them for doing this, man. It's really cool, man. We're accomplishing something for the greater good, and people are starting to notice that. So, Sherry, how's Kurt doing? He's doing something different, ain't he?
Yes, and it's just so nice after, what, like 15 years on this?
Ripping and running.
He's getting, it's nice to have him back, the old Kurt. And the new Kurt is, he's so much fun to be around again. And I knew that when he was younger, but you know, it went away for a while. Yeah, so I really like that. And he's actually, he does what he says he's going to do. He's helping out at home. He's got a full-time job already, so I'm very proud of him.
Good, we're proud of him too, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, because we know Kurt, we know he's one of us. He's been in and out a few times. Like you said, been ripping and running for 15 years. And that's kind of stressful on his parents.
Yeah, it's not been easy. But, you know, we've made it through. And hopefully things will just keep getting better.
I got every inclination to believe things will definitely get better for us, especially if it keeps on doing what we've been doing. I know from firsthand and secondhand experience, it's going to get unimaginably better. It's crazy, man. You just think, man, you've been out, what, a month now? Month and a half, yeah. And just look, man, how good it keeps getting. It's almost unbelievable, for real, man. Sometimes you
bought me lunch twice.
Imagine that.
Giving him money and he actually bought me.
That's right. I bet it wasn't Sue either, was it?
Come on, man. That's right. Twice before your lunch didn't have the words oodles or noodles. That's definitely something new, man. That's definitely something to be proud of. That's awesome, Sherry. So, have you seen the previous films that Kurt's been
in? No, I haven't.
You haven't? Get your mom a link to these films, man. It's on YouTube. It's really good. Kurt does a really good job every week, man.
He talked about you.
Been here. Yeah, sure he did. He's been here every week since he got out. He's been here, so. And for the cameraman, Kurt, you came out, and your very second day out of jail, you came to a 12-step meeting, right? And we ain't got rid of you since.
We ain't going to.
You're exactly right. We not going to get rid of you, and you don't get rid of us, because we family around here, you know?
And you know what, I want to say this too, when Kurt came home, right, I remember I was at the meeting that he came to, right, and he was like, man, I'm new, I need some help, I need some numbers, man. You know, that's
first night.
They tell you to do that stuff when you're in there, right? Yeah. Everybody I've ever seen that comes home and does that, stays clean.
I didn't want to do that.
You did.
Someone told me to do it, it was like, just do it, and then it had to be the podium meeting.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I
was like, oh, man.
Yeah, I thought I saw a ghost when I saw Kurt. I don't want to believe it. I was like,
what?
Like, is that him for real?
So Sherry, what they're talking about, I don't know if I told you in detail or not, but what they're talking about, man, is a 12-step meeting, a support group. You know, they suggest that you raise your hand and say, hey, I'm Cricket and I need help. Can y'all please give me some numbers or something like that? Well, this particular meeting that he showed up to was about 75 people. It was one of the biggest meetings that we have in this area on a Wednesday night. And he walked, he humbled himself and walked up to this podium in front of everybody, man, he did that. And that's crazy. I didn't think I'd ever see him do nothing like that.
It was hard, I ain't gonna lie.
I know it was hard. I know it was hard, man, but he's
here. If he went sober, he wouldn't have done it.
No, he wouldn't have done it. He might have went up there and told a joke or something. He went up there and he was real, man. And people saw that and people felt it. I felt it, so, you know, we snatched him up, we got him a bunch of numbers and stuff, man. The good thing is he's been using them. Sherry, I don't think he wants to go back.
I don't either. One of the first things that he did do also, which he's never ever done in the past, is he actually has a real sponsor. Mm-hmm. He used to make them up before to
imaginary sponsor.
But yeah, he actually, when he told me he had a sponsor, then I knew things were going to go in the right direction.
Good, man. So, I mean, proud. That's a good word to sum up how you feel about him.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Good, man. That's good, man. Hey, your mom's saying that kind of stuff, ain't it?
I even tried to babysit the grandbaby.
Oh, no.
His little niece, he babysits sometimes. So it's nice not to have to worry about anything.
That is awesome. I'm so glad you came tonight. And Kurt's going to get you them links to them videos, because you're going to be really proud. If you're proud of them now, you'll be really proud of them when you see this stuff on a publicly aired website, man. It's pretty cool. What about you, Sharon? You seen any of them?
I have not. Like,
get your mama the link.
Yeah.
Mark, you seen any?
I have not.
All right, well, we'll get your daddy the link, too. So, now, for those of y'all that remember Matt's story, man, Matt got in trouble
one time as an adult, man, the very first time, they gave him two. It was two.
I actually got in trouble before I was an adult. Wow. Was an adult.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. So, 18, you had to do right at 2 years, right, mm-hmm. in jail.
Oh, man.
And he didn't go to prison. He did all his time in jail, but the jail he was in, Pamunkey, sorry, put you on blast. It's hard time, man, because you was like locked in your cell for 18 hours. Mm. And he did some adjustment. He made a lot of good friends and that stuff, man. It's hard on him, man. I know it had been hard on y'all. That's your baby, right?
Yeah.
That's crazy, man.
It was a whole new world for us. I don't care to ever revisit. So we're super proud of him. It didn't go so well right out of the gate, and he didn't plug in like we had hoped. And so he had to decide when he was ready. And now we're what? Over 90 days.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Yeah.
Bumba's been out 6 months. Today's the 15th, 18th will mark 6 months out, and I've been clean for over half of it.
That's good stuff, man. Matt shared his story with us, man. He made a couple bad decisions right out the gate, man, because we just didn't follow the suggestions that was given.
Yeah, but like looking back on it, I couldn't be more grateful for my decision mm-hmm. because I knew I was an addict, but I thought I could handle drinking and I'd be fine. I thought as long as I removed myself from the wrong people, places, whatever, the triggers, remove all that stuff, I'd be fine just drinking. I thought I could handle that. And I quickly found out that wasn't the case. And if I would've, I feel like if I would've gone straight to recovery from jail, I would've always been wondering and would've ended up slipping up. So like now I know I cannot use any mind altering substance at all.
Right. Or just not equipped, man.
Yeah, it will just be like a snowball effect.
Yeah, we not member of the few, you know, people out there that can do things without consequences. In fact, I just had a discussion with a couple guys this week, man. You know, we got consequences, man. We can't drink. We can't take a bong hit. We can't push nobody's stem. We can't do nothing, man. If it changes us and our thinking, man, we go straight to shit thinking and we make bad decisions.
And I was so grateful that I was introduced to the McShin Foundation and recovery in jail through the program they started, because when I finally caught myself slipping, I knew where to go. I knew where to get help. I had finally had enough of the pain. Like I never would have expected that I would have been right back in that depression, that feeling of isolation and just desperation and loneliness. I never thought I would get back to that point when I was locked up, mm-hmm. and I had. So I just had enough of the pain.
Right. So it's kind of like a friendly reminder that, oh yeah, the pain is still out there. If you want some of it, you can come on back and get some.
For sure.
But the good news is that, you know, y'all son snapped back, man, you know. And I'll tell you what he did, man. He called some of the people that he met that was doing something different, you know, that he met in jail, that was doing something different now, doing a lot of positive, productive things. And whatever reason, pain got to him great enough and made him reach out and, you know, they pointed him in the right direction. He's been so open-minded. And Mark, you know, he's so willing to do, you know, basically anything that he's asked of from people that are doing something different. So, man, he's, I swear to God, man, we, you know, Matt's on his way for real. 4 out of 68 participants, 4, they chose to move into this apartment. He was the first one they asked. So, that was pretty cool. Well, I don't know if he was the first one they asked, but he was the first one that I found out he was moving into it. So, and y'all come, y'all, his parents are real active too, man. They love him to death, of course, they're his parents, but you know, they haven't given up on him. And truth is though, man, you know, for a lot of us, that ain't our story. A lot of us, man, we didn't stop at 20. We kept on doing stupid stuff and making more bad decisions, man. And our parents were just like, okay, there you go, do whatever you're gonna do. And, I guess I'll get caught up on my insurance policy. You know, that's reality for a lot of us, man. The good news is it ain't never gonna be like that for you. So I don't think y'all gotta worry about no insurance no time soon, but he's doing really good. And y'all come, we have like family nights at the organization we're in, man, where we have dinners and stuff like that, man. I see Matt's parents all the time. And you know, they always commenting on his Facebook stuff, and all of his people in his network that comment, you know, and like this stuff that people in his network put on there too, man. So that's awesome, man. Mark, you proud of him, ain't you?
So
so proud. Just, you know, our relationship's better than ever. And he's getting taller and taller, so that's But the one thing that I've got to commend everybody, you guys, it is the social network that helped support him that's made that happen. And I didn't realize all, you know, I was, you know, the discipline of him to do it is all what I only thought about. But when you realize, and this is something that guys, can, you know, watching it can take out, is this group will give you the support you need and make the difference. And it's that's what it's all about, because you can't go back to the old guys, you know. And this might sound, you know, a little different saying, but he encourages me to be better.
Good. That's right.
And I want him to know that how much I love him and how much he encourages me, because if he can overcome stuff, you know, there's things that I can get better at too. And so, you know, it's our job as individuals to always see that message.
Don't that feel good, man? You get your daddy and your mom sitting beside you. They raised you. And now your daddy's sitting there telling you that what you do gives him hope, that he can believe in himself, that he can do better in life too.
Yeah, it's kind of a lot to take in.
That's a Packer fan.
Man, that's, I'm getting ready to cry. And you ain't even my daddy, man. Damn, man, that's all right, dude.
Yeah, but like you were saying, on the network thing, like, that is huge for my recovery process. Like, perfect example, Ryan here is my sponsoring brother, and he's helped me countless times. Like, I've called him a bunch of times in times of struggle, and he's gotten me through it, helped me not do something stupid. So, like, the network piece in my story is huge.
Save my life. Save your life. How many of y'all's lives the network save on a daily basis? Man, tell you what, man, when I go through bad stuff, man, sometimes it ain't easy to reach out and humble myself and ask somebody for help, man, but I make myself do it, and I never regret it, man. I never regret reaching out and calling a few people and saying, hey, you ain't gonna believe what my dumb ass is sitting here thinking.
I've never met you, but I thank you, because he's told me you always answer.
Oh, Ryan's awesome.
And Ryan, that's just, you know, that's great.
I want to say this too, though, like, it ain't a one-way street. Like if I'm helping him, it helps me just as much, just to know, you know what I mean, that somebody, that I can help somebody, and then helping him, like, sometimes, I've had Matt call me before where he was going through something, I was going through something similar. And so when I try to guide him, it's like, I gotta take a look at me too.
Right.
You know what I mean? So it helps put me in the right, that's how we do, man, this is give and take. It ain't, you know, like Mark was saying, you know, this whole thing just works like that. It's a cohesiveness, man, and the governments that we work together, you know, and it's amazing. I mean, I'm a little overwhelmed with emotion right now.
No.
That feeling, like, it makes me feel, you know, like, man, I ain't never had nobody want me for shit, man, you know what I mean, or need me for nothing. And to know that I've helped somebody, man, I can't even, you know.
Are you helping more than one? Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? We can do that too. It's the whole family, so.
The truth is, man, it's kind of like a domino effect, man. See, Ryan reaches out and helps Matt. Matt, in turn, is helping him because he just says, you know, he's listening to his own self-talk. They're giving Mark hope. We see him doing good. They give us hope, man. They make us believe in ourselves, man. The truth is, man, we value everybody in this community values you, just like we value everybody else in the circle, man. And it might be beyond belief to you, but we value you guys too. You know, we have not met many of you yet, man. When you come out, we would definitely include you in our family, man. It's great. Do y'all feel like we're in a family here when we come around here? And I mean, I ain't trying to sell this thing to you because I ain't getting no commission off of it. And that, for the record, is the truth. But the truth is, man, you know, we're like a family around here, man. How many of y'all ever go hungry or ain't never got no ride nowhere? Raise your hand if you never have a ride anywhere to do something productive. No hands. Raise your hand if you ever starve when you ain't got nothing to eat. No hands. What? Are you serious? That's pretty cool, man. That's really true. Your son is in a really cool family, man. He had to put the footwork in. He had to reach out. But once he reached out, man, we brought him on in, man, and we love him to death. You know, so y'all should definitely sure feel proud of him, man.
No, I wanted to say something too. Right. Like Ryan was saying, that the feelings that I'm getting, and just the encouragement to see that your parents are so supportive and how your dad is learning something from you is like, I look back and I hope, you know, that one day my daughter can say some stuff like that about me. You know what I mean? And it just gives me that motivation to get and stay where, you know, where I'm at, man. You know, I want my family, my kids to be proud of me. You know, I want to say, you know, when I first came here, I met Matt, and him and I pretty much, you know, the very beginning, you know. Him and I got a chance to hang out for like 4 days straight and get to know each other. Mm-hmm. And ever since then, we've had a bond.
Yeah.
You know, and your son is awesome, you know. Not trying to blow his head up, it's already big enough. but I love it. I love it, man, you know. And it was funny because, you know, I'm a little bit older than him. But it made me feel more of a, not like a dad. I am a dad, but you know what I'm saying, man. I feel like another brother, man. You know, we talked about that. And just hearing everybody and seeing the family here, and, you know, it gives me that encouragement. And that's what the meetings are all about. You know, if y'all get out of jail and you get into the group, you know, the herd, this is exactly what happens in these groups, man. It's the feelings. You know, that's what encourages me. So I just wanted to say that you got an awesome son.
Appreciate it.
And by the way, if y'all, you know, if many of y'all don't recognize him yet, you will recognize him soon because he's getting ready to be in some catalogs and some TV advertisements and stuff. And I'm his manager, so you can contact the McShin Foundation and they'll point you in my direction.
See your catalog
Yeah, he's going in it. He's going in Calvin Klein or something. We're going to get in there. And it's cool because I just so happen to have a really good photographer in my family, man, and she's really good. So, by the way, speaking of which, Dreamer, you're here. Dreamer, me and Dreamer have a really good bond, man. We're kind of like cousins by marriage. But the truth is, she's one of my dearest friends that I've ever had in my life. We got a bond that's like indescribable. But you also got a brother that's watching this. So she wanted to come, man. She's been like one of our biggest fans, man. I get more reviews from her than I do anybody else.
It's like the housewife.
And it's awesome, man.
I love it. I appreciate what you said about you had to realize that you couldn't drink too. Because my brother, who's gonna watch, needed to hear that. Yeah. Because when he comes out, yes, you know, when he gets out of there, he's gonna think that I can just, you know, beer won't hurt me. And that it's gonna lead to more. So you saying that, listen.
And like before I got released, I was dead set in my mind, I'm not using any other drugs. I'm not, and I say any other drugs, alcohol is a drug too, for y'all who don't know, but I wasn't even gonna smoke weed, nothing. I was just gonna drink. I got out Monday, I think it was Wednesday, I hit the blunt. Thursday, I was popping out of all kinds of stuff. I mean, it was that quick and progressive. Like, within the first week, I was using other drugs. And I was dead set in my mind not going to use anything before I got released. It was that quick.
It don't take long, man.
No.
Like I said, Drew, she's definitely talking to you on Washington, say your name. I didn't think, she probably didn't think she could, but we're going to put you out there, Drew. Yes. we're not equipped, man. The thing is, man, once we get in the, my bad decisions have consequences. Once we get in that club, man, our bad decisions always have consequences. Right. Ain't no going to jail for using and doing stupid stuff while we're using to going back to using successfully. None of y'all in here can say that, right? You didn't go to jail behind something stupid you did while you was using and then get out and use and not have no consequences from it, right? No hands for that either, man. So we eating good, we got rise places, and we know that we can't use because we make bad decisions when we do.
Well, I also want to say too that addiction has hit my family from many different positions. I have a sister who, I guess she's about a year and a half clean. She had a baby, and Ava changed her life. So her first birthday is coming up soon. And so, but I had like a really standoffish approach to her and to addiction in general. And I never really looked into meetings or going for family support or anything. But for Cricket to come out and send me these videos, the first one I watched, I was like, okay, I can see a totally different side of this. And so you changed my mentality of it too. So, that's, yeah, thank you.
So this thing is working, boys. We're giving hope to people, man. We're changing people's whole perception on addiction and the stigma. You know, y'all are gonna talk about the stigma of addiction, man, because all ads are bad and they're laying in the alley, homeless, drinking wine out of a paper bag and all that, man. The truth is, man, we're normal people. We got good parents. We got good family members. You know, we're capable of having good relationships, good friends. And, this group, afraid to kill me. This group, man, is being, you know, filmed like this, man. It's reaching out to people who wouldn't otherwise probably wouldn't have gave the whole idea a chance of even reconsidering, man, their idea of what we were like. Yeah. So that's pretty cool, man.
I was probably, you could have labeled me cold-hearted, and that would have been positively correct before.
Poor Dreamer watched that first film, man, and she texted me. She was like, "Oh my God, Cricket, I am so proud of you." She was like, "I'm gonna finish watching as soon as I stop crying." She was crying. She was so proud.
I mean, you know, like Cricket said, we just grew up together, and it's just one of those weird things. And I've always believed in Cricket. He's like one of the most intelligent guys I know. He has the best words. I mean, he can talk to you. He may toss in a few shits or. But I've always just believed in Cricket, and I knew that one of these days it was going to happen. And so I see the video, and I didn't actually miss the first video, but he sent me the second one. And I saw him here, like, conducting this meeting and talking with you guys, and I was like, okay, that's exactly where it was, and I just lost it. Very proud.
That's a good feeling, man, being proud of your family members, man. I mean, you know, she is crying because she's so overjoyed that somebody that she cares about is doing something different, man. Mm. And, you know, we some people like me, man, we threw away a lot of years, man, breaking our family's hearts and, you know, being locked up and having to write letters. And, you know, the letters are always sad. There ain't never no good letters when we write home, man. There ain't never no... You know, no good exciting news. It's always, you know, y'all know how to love you, right? But I'm really glad you came tonight. Dreamer's been wanting to come, man. So, and actually, her sister that she was just talking about, she's doing real good, man.
She's doing great.
She wants to come too.
She's doing, I mean, I don't know my sister. She got into drugs at 12 years old. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I didn't know her. You know, I knew she was a pretty cool kid, but I didn't know her. You know, and so meeting my sister again after she's become a mother too, it's been wonderful to see her blossom into, you know, pretty cool, fun, you know, person. Mm-hmm. It's nice to see.
Yeah, she's coming around, man. Hey, this is for you guys, man. She was just talking about her, you know, her perception of addiction or whatever, man. And that's, you know, partly I'm to blame for that, man, because I really fucked it up for the rest of y'all addicts, man, you know, for somebody like her. But now I've changed her whole perception over my actions and things I'm doing today. So when y'all get out, man, if your family gave up on you and all that, and don't nobody want to answer your phone calls or nothing, you know, I'm 100% certain you can change their perception, man, if you change your actions. So don't give up on yourself, man. Roxanne's back. Roxanne filmed for us last week. Y'all didn't get to meet her last week. Well, you've been watching the films, ain't you?
Yeah, remember last week I said I messed up? You know, the film. I was watching up and down like a dummy. I didn't think to turn it sideways so I could see the walls.
No, you did a really good job last week, man. And Nick's back there filming today. Nick will say hi before we end. Roxanne, you proud of Kirby now, right? You'd be a fool not to be. Boy's doing good, you know? What do you see him doing different this time than he has in recent years?
I see his smile coming back. He's more polite. Mm. He's home. He's not out all night. Like, I was reading this sheet. A lot of this is Cody, you know. But he never stole from me. That's one thing he didn't go through. But I just enjoy having him around and not seeing him hot. I mean, he's done almost died one time OD. Remember I was telling him?
Yeah.
For like 30 minutes, I didn't know if he was dead or alive. So I was like, God, please just let him live, you know. He's got so much more living to do. And then he had a hit and run. I mean, so many things kept on happening. And I didn't have anybody to help me. Everybody was trying to tell me what to do. But finally, the courts made him come here. We had a choice of either going to jail or coming here. And this is the best thing that's, I mean, for me and him both, my family. I had the perception you did, because I wanted to be an outpatient program, you know? Mm-hmm. And I thought, oh my God, I don't want him to start hanging out with people. I feel stupid saying that, but honestly, I thought, oh my God, I want him to come home every day. I don't want him to, what if he starts hanging out with them? And now I feel like a total idiot, because these are some of the best people, honest, you know. So I know where you're coming from, because I was, I'm not saying you're stupid, but I'm stupid like that.
I think a lot of people that do not understand the disease itself don't understand it. My family never has. My parents, my sisters and all, you know, they always look down on him.
And it wasn't a disease to me. That's not how I saw it. I mean,
and that's what
you
most
don't
people
choose cancer.
Think.
That was my mentality. Mm-hmm. But I, you know,
I look at it as, okay, for you guys to give up your drug of choice and all drugs, you know, it's kind of would be the same if I would try to give up sugar or something like that. Mm-hmm. I don't think I could do it, not at least on the first try.
It's hard. Ron made a good point earlier. It's hard, man. It's hard to stop using it. Once you stop using it, it becomes easier and easier every day to continue to not use it. Can y'all agree with that?
Yes, sir.
Right, but the stopping, man, you know, I ain't trying to get my sugar up neither. I ain't gave up a lot of shit. I'll hang on to that for a little while. But yeah, I think all the family members in here can relate to that, you know? It's
a lot of people try to condemn them, though, and talk bad about them, you know? Nobody really tried to help me. They were just telling me what I need to be doing, you know?
So now y'all's sons and, you know, your family members and friends, they're doing something different, man, and they're living a different way. And y'all kind of want, it gives y'all kind of the desire to learn something about this, to educate yourselves about the disease of addiction.
Right.
Is that fair to say?
Mm-hmm.
Right, and the more you learn, the more you realize that it actually is a disease, man. It's something that he was born with, it's something he was born with, it's something he was born with, and it's not curable, man. It's treatable, though, and this is his treatment right here. What he's doing in his present-day life is his treatment. And he never has to suffer something from his disease ever again as long as he treats it. Right. It's just way worse than cancer has ever been, man. It's bad. And I say cancer isn't bad because it is, but this is.
Well, you think I'd know it. I mean, my family are full of addicts.
Right.
So you think I'd know. This is a born with thing. It's not something that, you know, I get it now.
Yeah.
Plus, we don't have to wait to go to sleep. I used to, like, wait for him to pull in the driveway.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe 2 or 3 in the morning, you know.
Scared to death.
Yeah, and I'm like, thank you, God. But a couple times that didn't happen, but now I can go to sleep, you know.
Y'all hear that desperation she was talking about, man? She found her kid, you know, almost died.
I didn't find him. His friend called and told me he wasn't breathing.
Right.
And I didn't have a car to get to him. So I had to wait like 30 minutes until a cop called me and said they gave him that, what's that drug thing? Yeah, and they said he was like in and out. But I was like, oh my God, I mean. So I was like on my knees praying, like, God, if it's your will, let him be here, you know. So he's still here for some reason, so.
Must be God's will.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad he's here, man, because he actually, man, you know, when he was living with us, man, he definitely brought some cheer to the house and stuff, man. He's a little goofy little dude, man. But you know, we love that about him, you know. We were 19, we were goofy too, so. That's cool, man. I'm so glad that y'all came this week, man.
Me too.
Paid other family members to come and have to buy them dinner. It's a good thing I'm broke. I spent it all on newcomers last night at the Vietnamese place.
Soup.
But, yeah, I didn't buy a suit, man. The guy I took out didn't buy a suit. So, he's not going with us again. Truth is, man, that the more, you know, the more y'all's family members, the better they do, the more y'all gonna wanna learn about this thing, and then the more you're gonna wanna come around and support him, and the more you're gonna wanna get involved, and it's a really cool thing, because y'all get to learn stuff that you didn't know. You get to get hope from us, and you know, and we feed off each other, because y'all are showing interest now in their lives, because you're so proud of them, and we're loving it, because we've been beating y'all up for so long, making y'all pray to God for us to make it one more day.
That's true.
You know, it's terrible, man, but that's what we do, man. The truth is, I wanted to get these family members in here this week just so that we could all be brought back into reality, that our actions don't just affect us, man, but that, you know, we got people that love us, and they're, you know, our actions definitely affect them, man. You know, they're the ones that we call when we're in jail for 15 months, and
you know, commissaries next week, and holiday packs coming out next month, and I sure could use a visit and all that. That stuff's hard for them. Is it hard for y'all to go on a visit? Your son have to leave.
I can't believe he was 2 years. He was 15 days, and I hated it. So
I was 2 years on my last bed.
It was hard. It was really hard. Well, I was. I had two brothers, grandparents. It affected more than you.
It affected
everybody. Do y'all? We old heads now. Y'all realize that? So do y'all older heads realize? Do y'all agree that his parents ain't never got to go see him through glass again if he continues down the path he's on?
Yeah, right. I want to say this too. I said it before y'all came in, but like, you know, I was talking to Cody's mom, and we was talking about, you know, for most of us, I don't know, Brad's got a good relationship with his parents, right? I got a good relationship with my parents, but as far as like my daily life, like because of the things I did, mm-hmm. like you were saying, like y'all parents are here right now, that's great. Like I'm so happy for y'all. But if you continue doing what I did for the majority of my adult life, there'll be a time when your parents ain't gonna wanna sit right beside you no more. They're gonna back off. Mm-hmm. Cause they can't continue putting themselves through that pain. Right. You know, I took my parents, that my parents will come in the beginning, come around, be a part, but it's like when you build that hope up and then you smash it over and over and over again, you know, in order to protect themselves, they gotta back off. You know? And I mean, it's difficult for me sometimes. I know that I don't have the relationship that I want with my parents, but you know, I'm also a lot older. And you know, I do have a good relationship with my family, but you know, life goes on. You know, I hate that I did the damage I did to them, but you know, I mean, we do have a relationship. I just encourage, you know, the guys that are here to stay clean, man. Don't take your parents through what I took my parents through, mm-hmm. you know, because, you know, I regret that every day as my parents get older. You know, it started getting to the point where I started thinking like, you know, they ain't gonna be around much longer. You know, how am I gonna feel when they gone?
That's a hell of a thought, man. Yeah. That's reality for us, man. The truth is we lost a lot of time, man, making the stupid, reckless decisions that we made. But, you know, here's the thing, man. Our parents are proud of us. Now, there's parents in this room, man, family members, and they're sitting here telling y'all, man, on public filming that they're proud of their family members for doing whatever they're doing. So no matter what we did in the past, because we're not dwelling on that no more, right?
Sure.
We're living in the moment, and we're planning for the future, but we ain't even stressing on the future for real, because we ain't got no control over that, really, neither. So we live for the moment now, and we make sure that we do the best we can in that moment, right, Ron? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm trying to say.
Boy, good, man. So and as a result, man, our families are proud of us, and they want to come around, and they come to events that we have, and they, you know, they allow their sons to buy them lunch and stuff. I know that affected you, because I bought my mom a pack of cigarettes a couple months ago, and she cried, and everybody that she works at came out, was like, oh my God, that's so sweet. You know, because mama, you know, and everybody watching this in my family knows, you know, anytime I used to come in there, I was coming to collect, not to donate.
You know. First paycheck, he handed me $50.
$50, man. Tyrone didn't get it.
Nobody got that.
Your mama got that money.
He just, here.
See,
that's
it
great.
Was nice, yeah, he took a lot of money. He stole a lot of things. He and his brother.
Look at him, that little smile. Oh,
bless him.
I mean, Xboxes and Wii's and PlayStations we went through.
Yeah. All electronics.
See, I had two
Netflix.
They
didn't last very long.
Oh, wow. So I didn't, it wasn't fair to them that they lost their things, so we'll buy them again, and then they just peer again.
All right, so I just really want to thank y'all for coming, man, because you know we come so big to pass the message of hope to the guys and girls that are still in jail, and you know, we definitely wanted them to see that our families do come back around, they do care, they do believe in us when we do right. So I just want to really thank y'all for coming this week, man. Yes. So y'all are our biggest supporters, man. If you know. If that circle, that I'll scratch your back, scratch my back thing we were talking about earlier, man. If when y'all weren't feeding off of the hope, and we weren't feeding off of the good feelings that we get from y'all's hope, then our chances of staying out of jail greatly diminish. So thanks, guys. For the record, we're at 2300 Dunbar Road at the McShin Foundation at a church called Ash Memorial Baptist. It's in Richmond, Virginia, and we do this every week between 6 to 7. However, sometimes we do go over, sometimes we do start a little late, but we do it for approximately an hour, and if you get out and you're doing something different to not go back in, then we would love to have you in there, man, giving back this message of hope. So what we normally do, man, look, and I changed, y'all probably wondering why I didn't ask y'all about these. I got to thinking about it, and I don't know if we'll share that, you know, because this is kind of like y'all's cheat sheet, not ours. So these things on this sheet, man, they're going to look out for, man, because, you know, we pull the wool over our people's eyes, man. But don't kill me. I ain't put this thing up, but I'm definitely going to give it to them, you know, because we want to, you know, be accountable for our stuff, right? Don't you want to be accountable for your stuff? So when you start doing, asking for gas and grocery money at unreasonable rates, or eating a lot of food at odd hours of the night, when you start doing that stuff, you want your parents to be able to say, hey, man, you know, are you fucking up? Are you getting high?
Are you in the kitchen at 2:30 in the morning?
Something's up, man, you know, because it might just
get back on track. Rain, you know.
All right, so what we're going to do, man, we're going to meet back here next Sunday like we always do, man. We're going to keep sending y'all this message, man. So let's circle up, and we're going to close out with this ring. Huh? Nick, turn around and say hi to the boys, man. Y'all must get
hey, what's up?
That's Nick. Y'all remember Nick, man. He lives with us. He's our good friend, man. He's so awesome. He comes up here and videotapes for us when he can. All right, come on, Nick, since you ain't done all our talking, man. We're going to take us out here.
Are we not?
God, grant us serenity to accept the things we cannot change, the courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Just for today, keep coming back. Works if you work, if you die, if you don't, so work if you live.
All right, good job. All right.